they believed, and now there's a lot for Americans to celebrate. The women's soccer team winning the World Cup. What an ending to the 4th of July weekend. A woman's body pulled from the water at a city beach in Granbury. Now investigators are trying to figure out why she drowned. A 12-year-old boy found shot multiple times in East Dallas, who police think may be responsible.
The news leader, broadcasting for all North Texas. Fox 4 News starts now.
Your U.S. women's national team takes home the FIFA Women's World Cup trophy for the first time in 16 years. Good evening. I'm Richard Ray. The women beat Japan in the final 5-2 in a game many of you saw here on Fox 4. Edward Egros joining us with highlights from the match in Vancouver. And Ed, there were a lot of great moments, a lot of them in the first 20 minutes.
Absolutely, Rich. It was hard to predict how Team USA would start the match. It was a rematch of the last Women's World Cup final, when the Stars and Stripes lost a one-goal lead twice, then fell on penalty kicks. How much would revenge fuel these ladies? Well, we wouldn't have to wait long for an answer. Just 3 minutes into the match, off the corner, Captain Carly Lloyd waits and pokes with a left foot. 1-0 United States. Everything went right for Team USA in the first 16 minutes. After another Lloyd goal, she fires from the midline and winds up with a hat trick, the first in a final in the tournament's history. Japan cut that 4-0 lead in half, thanks in part to an own goal by Julie Johnston. But Tobin Heath makes the U.S. comfortable again. Off the corner and later in. And for the first time since 1999, the United States wins the Women's World Cup 5-2, the final.
Speechless. Honestly, I'm so proud of this team. This doesn't feel real. It hasn't sunk in. I was just on a mission. I was on a mission to help my team win this game. Personally, I've worked my butt off, and you know, everything, all the repetitions, everything came into play.
I'm just so proud of this team and these players, and so happy for them. So happy for every little girl that dreams about this.
There are a lot of milestones achieved here. It's the third championship for Team USA, the most of any country. It's also the most lopsided win of any USA championship. And tonight at 10 on Sports Sunday, you'll hear more from the team about what went into the making of this incredible win. Edward Egros, Fox 4 Sports.
More soccer in North Texas today. Men's soccer at the Cotton Bowl. Thousands packing the stands for the Socio MX Cup Championship game featuring CF Monterey and Cruz Azul, two popular teams with big followings decked out in their respective colors. Fans showing up from all over Texas and as far away as Mexico.
We grew up with that in Mexico, and I mean, all the Latin America, Central America, soccer for us is like our life, our heart, you know.
Cruz Azul wins it 1-0, the annual tournament televised in more than 20 countries.
Overall, a pretty nice day across North Texas. Seasonable temperatures and a fair amount of sunshine. Really no rain to speak of here. We started out at 77 at DFW, warming to 93. Now the normal high temperature for this time of year is 95 degrees. Radar picture looking really nice. We've seen showers and storms in East Texas. That's where that activity is staying. I'm expecting mainly clear skies and a pretty quiet night for all of us. Current temperatures hanging in the mid and upper 80s, still 88 in Fort Worth, 89 in Dallas. Winds remain with a southerly component, kind of breezy in the 10 to even 20 mile an hour range. That will continue for us tonight, and that strong southerly wind will pick up even more to start your work week, sustained close to 25 miles an hour by tomorrow. Now your Monday is dry, but I am tracking a front that's moving into the plains tonight that tries to get closer to North Texas Tuesday into Wednesday. Just some small rain chances for us. We'll talk more about that and a look at the temperatures for the upcoming week in just a bit.
Gang detectives are investigating the shooting death of a 12-year-old boy in Dallas. Police say it happened shortly before 2 p.m. in the 3500 block of Munger Avenue. Officers found the boy. He had multiple gunshot wounds. He was taken to the hospital, is expected to live. Officers stopped a suspect's vehicle as it was leaving that location. Police say they made contact with people who are known gang members. Youth and gang detectives both working together to investigate the shooting. Police have not released any other detail on this crime at this time. A disturbing number of children have drowned in Texas since January. The Department of Family and Child Protective Services puts the number now at 41. Another drowning in North Texas on Saturday, a woman at a popular beach in Granbury. Fox 4's James Rose has that story.
With all the recent drownings in North Texas, including the one here in Granbury this weekend, virtually all the people we talk to have water safety on their mind, whether it's a swimming pool or on the banks of the Brazos.
Just after 6 Saturday, the Brazos River Authority says an 18-year-old woman drowned at City Beach in Granbury just off the boardwalk. Shanna Fikes did not see the victim dive into the water, but says there were a lot of people ignoring the warning signs.
Well, there was a bunch of kids out jumping off of the bridge over there, doing backflips and jumping in the water.
BRA investigators have not determined if the woman jumped off the boardwalk or was simply swimming at the time.
Yeah, it was pretty troubling.
I'm being in the same water as somebody that had an accident. It's kind of scary and creepy at the same time.
Daniel Etheridge and his family were hesitant to come to the Granbury City Beach, but decided to come with caution.
We always make sure to keep his life jacket on and make sure he doesn't go out in deep waters without it. So we're pretty vigilant when it comes to how his safety is in the water.
It's nice. I mean, I love coming here in the morning. Nice, you know, water's a little cooler and get a good swim in, so.
Thomas Birch loves the water and beach, but is also aware of the hazards.
I'm not going to dive out there. My other son, he's 22, and his son just got paralyzed diving into a lake in low water about a year ago.
With all the North Texas lakes and rivers topped off with fresh rainwater, lake recreation will soon be on the rise, and this might just be a good time for a water safety refresher. In Granbury, James Rose, Fox 4 News.
A 22-year-old man from Josephine, Texas, was flown to the hospital after a firework exploded in his hand early this morning. Josephine is just southwest of Greenville. Police say it happened at a home near FM 1778 and County Road 597. Officials say the man was at a house party when the firework blew up in his hand shortly before 4 a.m. No other injuries. The victim was flown to Parkland Hospital with what we are told are serious injuries. Fireworks were responsible for a lot of emergency calls on the 4th of July. Fort Worth Fire Department working more than 1,000 fireworks-related calls yesterday, and that's more than 3 times the number of calls it typically handles in a 24-hour period. But fireworks were not responsible, we're told, for any fires in Fort Worth. We checked with Dallas Fire Rescue as well. DFR working 45 fire calls over a 12-hour period. Not clear how many of those were fireworks related, but DFR says that is higher than its usual volume of calls. Dallas Fire Rescue also sent us these photos of fireworks that its crews confiscated on Saturday. Fire investigators and police officers collecting over 1,000 pounds of fireworks and issuing 2 citations. Fireworks are banned within city limits. A firefighter was injured overnight while battling a fire in Pelican Bay. That's near Azle. Officials say it happened after midnight Sunday in the 1600 block of Coral Road. One firefighter was taken to a nearby hospital for heat exhaustion. The firefighter's condition not known, but his injuries are said to be non-life threatening. Investigators believe that fire was started by fireworks. Dallas firefighters put out a house fire in the 500 block of South Clinton Avenue in North Oak Cliff. That happened about 4:15 this morning. Firefighters say they arrived to find the flames and the smoke billowing from the back of the house. It was quickly contained. No one was hurt. Cause of the fire still being investigated. A car crash turns into a bigger problem for hundreds of Sigaville phone customers. The damage left behind, why it could be a while before that mess is cleaned up. A domestic dispute turns deadly in Dallas. The woman who said she was assaulted is now the suspect in a case that will go to a grand jury. 2 people are dead after an officer-involved shooting at an Austin hotel just blocks from the state capitol. The call that brought police to the Omni Hotel and what they found inside. The traffic accident early this morning in Seagoville knocked out phone and internet service to a few hundred residents and several city buildings. Police say an AT&T terminal box was damaged by a vehicle in the 700 block of Highway 175 service road. The box serviced about 700 customers. It also provided service for city buildings, including the police department, city hall, and the library. City officials say 911 calls are still being answered.
We do have a what we call a rollover, and for our 911 system, that if we get overwhelmed with 911 calls, it automatically rolls over to our backup agency, which any type of outage or any type of situation, it automatically does it.
Seagoville police have increased patrols in the city. AT&T said it could take several days before that service is fully restored. A woman died this afternoon after being run over in a domestic dispute near Love Field. Police say the 32-year-old suspect was being assaulted in the 2400 block of Burbank Street. Investigators say she tried to leave by getting in her car and driving away. As she was doing so, officers say another woman walked to her driver's side, continued the argument. Officers say the driver then ran over that woman and she was pronounced dead at the scene. The driver faces a possible charge of criminal negligent homicide. Dallas police say a 21-year-old man was shot and killed Saturday afternoon while driving in his car. It happened about 5:20 in the Pleasant Grove area. Police say Jake Vion Hatley was shot to death by someone in a tan or a gold Mercury Grand Marquis. Crime Stoppers offering a reward of up to $5,000 for information that leads to an arrest. Three people are dead after two early morning officer-involved shootings in Austin. Austin police responded to two different locations within a nine-mile radius, one of them in a North Austin neighborhood, the other at a downtown hotel, the Omni. Fox's Jennifer Kendall has more.
A difficult day for the Austin Police Department. It's a difficult day for our officers.
A frantic call just before 5 a.m. from the Omni Hotel.
There was a male in the lobby who was walking around with a gun.
Within 2 minutes, the caller told dispatchers to send an ambulance because there was a victim.
We have no information to show that this was anything other than a random event, that this victim was a person who just walked into the hotel lobby and had his life taken. We have no indication that this was anything other than that.
Police arrived to a chaotic scene.
This individual was inside the Omni Hotel with a rifle. He shot and killed one person that is down in the lobby of the Omni Hotel. He then fired multiple shots inside the Omni, both around the hotel and at the officers that responded to the scene.
Officers fired back, killing the suspect.
Once we got into the elevator, there was a woman and a young kid, and she said it sounded like fireworks, but then we were told that someone had gotten shot in the lobby.
Hotel guests say they never imagined waking up so close to a crime scene Sunday morning.
Completely shocked. I mean, especially from being from Connecticut, you plan on a vacation, you know, and you hear something like that, it's a little scary. It's crazy.
This is not anything any officer ever wants to be involved in, is having to take a life. But unfortunately, our officers were put in circumstances today where that took place.
Just an hour earlier, 9 miles away, three Austin police officers faced another armed man. This time, the man called dispatch himself.
He appeared to be distraught. He made comments that gave the 911 call taker indications that he may be suicidal.
When officers confronted the man near the intersection of Golden Quail Drive and Pine Knoll Drive, they noticed he was carrying a weapon. Police say the man would not follow orders.
Our officers attempted to handle this with the use of less lethal force using a taser. This was ineffective, and the subject retreated back into his residence at this point.
Police say the man returned just moments later with obvious self-inflicted wounds, still carrying the weapon.
At this point, the officers observed the subject reach for his weapon instead of complying with their commands, and the officers at that point fired at the suspect in fear for their safety.
Before 5 a.m., both suspects were dead along with a victim at the Omni. Police say it's a tragic day for everyone involved.
Our hearts go out to the families of the individuals involved today, both the victim at the Omni behind us, whose life was taken by the suspect, as well as the individuals that we had to encounter.
The officer who shot the suspect at the Omni, as well as all three officers who shot the man in North Austin, are now on administrative duty while an investigation is conducted. The Omni Hotel is open to guests at this point, although they are asking everyone to enter and exit through a garage while they work to clean up the lobby. A fire at a chemical plant near Houston lit up the sky last night. That fire reported about 9 p.m. at the Flochem facility. The company produces chemicals used to refine oil and other liquids. A temporary shelter was set up for people living near the burning plant. The Harris County Fire Marshal's Office investigating what started the fire. There are no injuries. Evacuees were allowed to return to their homes early this morning. An American Airlines manager and Arlington native arrested in an undercover child sex sting is scheduled to be in court this week. 55-year-old Ray Howland was arrested last week on several charges, including criminal attempt to commit rape of a child. Investigators say he arranged to have sex with a woman and her 10-year-old girl, but the woman was actually an undercover agent. Howland is being held in a $150,000 bond in Pennsylvania, where he was arrested on June 29th. He is due in court on Tuesday. Escape prisoner David Sweat was released from a hospital in New York. He's now back in prison. Sweat was transferred early this morning. The 35-year-old was one of two inmates who escaped from the Clinton Correctional Facility in upstate New York on June 6th. He was shot twice by a state police sergeant after 22 days on the run. His accomplice, Richard Matt, was shot to death by a federal agent. Some Republicans blasting Donald Trump now over his comments on immigrants from Mexico. Jeb Bush, he called it offensive, but Ted Cruz defends Trump. That's still ahead. And the Dallas football team winning in the playoffs, but these players are women. Coming up, you're going to meet a couple of them. That's in the now. The United States won the Women's World Cup tonight, and it was a huge draw here in Dallas as North Texas soccer fans gathered to cheer on the team for a title in the final. Fox 4's Zahid Arab is at the Granada Theater with more on that. Hi, Zahid.
Hey, Rich, you know, more than 400 people packed the Granada Theater tonight to watch Team USA versus Japan Part 2. And it was the ending everyone hoped for.
You guys ready? Are you guys ready?
At the Granada Theater, the script is set.
I got all my colors on. Got my my socks.
Team USA versus Japan.
Let's go, girls!
For fans, words aren't needed, only the fist bump.
USA! USA!
It's a symbol they believe.
Ready to take the World Cup.
Tonight is a sequel to 2011.
It was crap. It was absolute crap to lose.
They beat us in the last World Cup. And we beat them at the Olympics, so we have a gold medal, but we don't have a World Cup. And you can ask any soccer player, they'd rather have a World Cup.
And just like that, this story becomes a statement. Made again.
Great! Great! Two goals!
Again. And you get the idea.
There's no chance they're coming back. Their heart left about 20 minutes ago.
After a long, tough battle, finally, redemption.
Redemption, payback, in your face, everything.
For a team and for a nation.
USA!
With an exclamation. Now, after the trophy presentation, some of the crowd was still so hyped up from the win that they actually got outside the theater and started walking down Greenville Avenue, waving the American flag and chanting Team Go USA. You know, Rich, I've got a good suspicion that a lot of people here tonight may not have a voice tomorrow morning.
I think you're right. It was a World Cup whooping. Thank you, Zahid.
They work hard in the offseason and even harder on the gridiron. Women's football is a growing sport, and a new Dallas team is really making a name for itself. Joining me now is the Dallas Elite women's football team owner and head coach, Odessa Jenkins, and wide receiver, Alberta Brightson. Thank you both for coming in.
Thank you for having us.
Hey, and congratulations on your inaugural season and making the playoffs.
Fantastic
news. So your season is spring and summer, basically.
Yes.
Why did you decide to start the team?
You know, growing up, I've always been an athlete. I grew up in a big family and was always the girl involved in with the boys playing the sport. And I wanted to afford young girls the opportunity to do something that was just for them in a male-dominated sport. And coming to Dallas, coming to Texas, where football is king and queen, it was just obvious that we needed to have an organization that everybody in Texas, everyone in Dallas and Fort Worth could be proud of.
And you've seen a lot of support?
Oh, huge support. There are a lot of women who play this game that everyone knows, but they don't really know that they play football. Like mm-hmm. we said, my quarterback is a chiropractor, and she walks out of her office after popping your back, and she puts her helmet on. So
that's awesome.
You know, but the reason I think that football was my next business venture is because I wanted to walk away from sports when I walk away, knowing that I helped empower women. And that's all that this is about.
Alberta, you are a mom of two young girls.
Yes.
You play football. Being a mom, how much did that factor into this decision to play?
Oh, well, I mean, much like Odessa, you know, I had brothers growing up, and, you know, that kind of sparked me. Now I have two girls, and they want to do everything that I do. And I just wanted to show them that there are opportunities out there for them to be whoever they want to be, do whatever they want to do. And I wanted to play long enough so that they can remember that, you know, mom did this. And, you know, this is something that if I want to do it, I have that option to do it. I don't have to do it. I'm not forcing them into it. But if this is something that they want to pursue, they can.
And why did you pick football? I mean, you're an athlete, so you really probably could have done anything and been great at it.
It was just like second nature, being an athlete and being a competitor. You know, I wanted to compete on that national level. There are teams all over the United States, and, you know, we've even been able to go overseas and play for Team USA. So, you know, it was just a great opportunity to get that competitive side of me out. You know, being in the corporate world, you can't do that. And, and then being a mom, you know, being a mom, you know, there's another hat that you wear, but, you know, here you get to just be free to be whoever you are.
I mean, you're a mom, so you've got the time commitment. Obviously, this is taxing on your body.
even financially, because these women put everything into it.
Yes, they do. On average, a women's football player pays about $2,000 per season to finance their season. And that comes from just hard work and hustle. There's no major sponsor. Nike isn't calling us yet. Yeah. but it's all about teamwork and family and hustle, you know, all the things that women sort of do naturally.
Well, fantastic job this season, and I look forward to seeing you guys play, to see the team in action, offer support, and if you just want to learn, you can, of course, log on to our website, fox4news.com. All right.
Thank you.
Good luck,
awesome.
Ladies.
Awesome.
Thank you.
We brought your bracelet.
Ah, yes. Thank you.
Be elite.
Be elite. Awesome. All right. Thanks so
Thank
much.
You.
Thank you.
The Pope has arrived in South America on a three-nation tour. We'll show you his first stop. Plus, Secretary of State John Kerry says talks with Iran are now at a crossroads and could go either way, the latest from Vienna. The United States and Iran are in deep negotiations now over whether a nuclear deal can be reached before a self-imposed deadline. That's just a few days away now. Negotiators for the U.S. and Iran and five other world powers are all trying to finalize an accord. The current deal under discussion would see Iran receiving phased-in sanctions relief in exchange for intrusive nuclear inspections. Secretary of State John Kerry says he's willing to walk away if Tehran does not show improvement and movement on the areas of disagreement.
If hard choices get made in the next couple of days and made quickly, we could get an agreement this week. But if they are not made, we will not.
Critics charge that Kerry's caving to Iran. His aides call that allegation absurd. The future for the economy of Greece is uncertain tonight after a nationwide vote to reject strict austerity measures proposed by international creditors. 61% of those voting said no on the proposal. Thousands of Greeks celebrating in the streets of Athens. Several Greek leaders hailing it as a victory, saying this could be a chance for the country to get a better deal.
Today, all of us together turned a bright page in modern European history. We proved that even under the most difficult circumstances, democracy cannot be blackmailed.
The vote results leave Greece in uncharted waters, risking financial and political isolation within the eurozone and a possible economic collapse if creditors refuse further aid. The European Council President has called a Eurozone summit for Tuesday to figure out what is next for Greece. It's been a busy weekend for presidential candidates. Donald Trump now taking fire from some fellow Republicans over his comments on immigrants from Mexico. Jeb Bush says he found them personally offensive, but Texas Senator Ted Cruz defended Trump's stand on immigration. Kristen Fisher has more from Washington.
Well, the Clinton campaign is well known for its ability to keep the press at bay, but this takes it to a whole new level. This wasn't just any rope line. This was a moving rope line that kept the press away from the candidate as she walked in a 4th of July parade. Campaign aides say they brought out the rope because they were afraid the press pack would block the view of the parade. But the state's Republican committee chair called the use of a moving rope line a, quote, sad joke that insults the traditions of our first-in-the-nation primary. Now, on the Republican side, some big news about fundraising. Ted Cruz announced today that his campaign, combined with his super PAC supporters, have raised $51 million in less than 4 months. That is a huge number, and it puts him in the very top tier of Republican candidates in terms of fundraising. Today, Cruz was on one of the Sunday morning shows talking about same-sex marriage and his proposal for a constitutional amendment that would subject Supreme Court justices to retention elections.
It is profoundly troubling when you have Supreme Court justices not following their judicial oath and taking the role of policymakers and legislators rather than being judges.
One of his opponents, Chris Christie, strongly disagreed with that proposal and cited what they do in New Jersey as an alternative.
We appoint our justices for a 7-year term, and then after 7 years, the governor has the opportunity to again consider whether to nominate them then for a lifetime tenure. I don't want to see judges raising money and running for election.
One other issue that really divided the GOP field this week was immigration. Yesterday, Jeb Bush, whose wife is Hispanic, said he was personally offended by Donald Trump's comments about Mexican immigrants during his announcement speech. He thinks those kinds of comments hurt the Republican Party, but so far, Donald Trump has offered no apologies. In Washington, Kristen Fisher, Fox News.
Pope Francis has arrived in Ecuador for a three-nation tour of South America. Thousands already lining the motorcade route in the capital of Quito. The pontiff will also visit Bolivia and Paraguay before returning to Rome on July 12th. Pope Francis last visited South America in 2013, where some 3 million people gathered in Rio de Janeiro for a mass. The Catholic Church has an estimated 1.2 billion followers all around the world, but the biggest portion of that does live in Latin America.
Seasonably hot temperatures over the past week, but now as we look ahead, those numbers will start to go up. Triple digits in the future, we'll talk about it coming up.
Another alligator attack in Texas, but this time the victims survive. And it won't be open to the public until later this week, but tonight Lone Star Adventures gets a sneak preview, an exclusive look at a new rainforest exhibit. That's a place where you can put your hands on some creatures that look really scary, but really aren't.
I'm Edward Egross in for Mike Ducey. Later tonight on Sports Sunday, a recap of the most dominant performance by Team USA in Women's World Cup history. You'll hear from the ladies about their hot start and earning their first championship in 16 years, and we'll take you to possibly the most boisterous watch party in the Metroplex and hear how proud they are of Carly Lloyd, Abby Wambach, and company. In open mic, Adam Hochfelder, editor of Dave Campbell's Texas Football Magazine, discusses why Texas and Texas A&M need to get over it and renew the rivalry. Also tonight.
Whoever retires to the referee.
A young man gets to pursue his dream of coaching basketball. The inspirational story of Coach Corey tonight at 10 on Sports Sunday.
popular year-round attraction in the Mid-Cities is about to open a big new rainforest exhibit, one that Lone Star Adventures got a sneak preview of last week. It's a place that will allow visitors to get their hands on some pretty scary-looking but surprisingly friendly creatures. We're headed to Grapevine Mills Mall and Sea Life Grapevine Aquarium. Sea Life Grapevine opened 4 years ago this month. 45,000 square feet of interactive and immersive exhibits, designed first and foremost for children. But something new is coming to the big aquarium, the Rainforest Adventure. We are taping this 10 days before the exhibit actually opens. There's a few things in the tanks, a shovel-nosed catfish, but by the time visitors get here, the tanks will be filled with all sorts of wild creatures from the Amazon River Basin, including piranhas in holding tanks for now.
We don't want to just throw them directly into our display because difference in pH, it can kind of shock the fish, so we kind of want to ease them into the new exhibit.
But many of the new guys are land creatures.
My friend right here is our bearded dragon named Mishu. This bearded dragon is one of our new addition to our Rainforest Adventure. We're going to use him as one of our program animals. This is actually going to be a fully immersive hands-on experience. We have a lot of different exhibits where you can actually pop up inside of the tanks. You see our animals up close.
Snakes, a tiny tomato frog, another reptile called a skink.
We're going to have a few opportunities throughout the day where our education staff is actually going to be stationed with different animals, and you're going to have the ability to touch one and just kind of feel exactly what they feel like. It's very awesome. It's going to be a great experience for the kids.
All sorts of creatures that look fearsome but really aren't.
Keep them close to you, so kind of hold them tight and bring them close to your chest.
Oh, he likes to be on the chest here?
Or close to your chest. Oh, he might just go on your shoulder. There you go.
Okay.
There you go. I think he's happy.
He's happy.
And if he's not happy, he would actually puff up his beard. That's why they call it a bearded dragon.
Most of the new program animals are former pets, abandoned and rescued, eventually making it here to Sea Life.
He's such a dinosaur.
Sure to be a hit is this big guy, an Argentine black and white tegu lizard, found wandering in Flower Mound and turned over to the Humane Society there.
They held on to him for a few weeks to see if anyone claimed him. Nobody did. Unfortunately, they called us to see if we are interested, and of course we were. He's going to make an amazing educational animal. And do you want us to actually see what he feels like?
Sure.
Sea Life staff is getting to know their new program animals, and as they do, more and more will be introduced to visitors.
Well, these guys are really special because they actually have really unique personalities. They say they're really similar to cats and dogs. They know their names. Sometimes they can learn to come when called. They have just really great personalities, so we're beyond thrilled to have him.
The tegu is leash trained and loves to be walked.
So we'll be able to walk around the aquarium with him, and I'm sure our guests are going to be really excited to learn more about this critter.
Sea Life Grapevine's Aquarium's new Rainforest Adventure opening Friday, July 10th. That's next Friday. For more on it, you can check it out on our website. You can buy dozens of Lone Star Adventures on fox4news.com. Click on News, find the Lone Star tab, bookmark, and visit often.
All right, finding one of those walking around in Flower Mound, that would be a little scary, but that's a really neat exhibit. It's going to be great for kids.
Yeah, and you caught that. Most of their program animals were abandoned pets of some kind or another.
It's a learning experience. Yeah. They've got a good
happy
home.
Ending.
And you can walk them on a leash. That right there, pretty amazing. It was a good day to take out your pet, walk on a leash
amazing
today, right?
Amazing weather today, this weekend.
Not bad. A lot of us were completely dry today compared to yesterday where we had some rain in the afternoon and evening hours. And temperatures were pretty seasonable, but a few of us did get above that normal 94, 95 degree mark. 97 from Jeremy Stevens in Denton, 94 Jenny Winneberg in Keller, 92 for Weatherford, 96 today from Albert Lawrence in Granbury. And currently, we're generally in the 80s. Bowie has not been producing correct temperatures for the past day or so ignore that one. But 84 in Denton, 85 in McKinney, 89 for Dallas and 88 in Fort Worth, and even 85 in Terrell. So a pretty good overall mild, pretty typical for this time of year. What has been throughout the day continues tonight. The wind, it remains out of the south, generally south-southeast, 10 to 15 miles an hour. Could even have gusts a little bit higher than that. We have for much of the day. So that strong southerly breeze is going to be here with us for at least a couple of days to start the work week. But so will this, a quiet radar picture for tonight, also going into your Monday. We've seen some showers in East Texas, not a whole lot happening here, especially compared to previous days, just no pieces of energy moving through, which is why it was so quiet for all of North Texas today, and that's why it'll be quiet tomorrow as well. But notice I said just tomorrow. By Tuesday, here comes our next system, this front producing some strong thunderstorms through portions of the plains tonight. Now, this time of year, it's very hard to get a cold front to move through North Texas. I do think it's going to stall just to our north. Now, it really all depends on where this actually goes. The closer it gets to us, the better our rain chances will be Tuesday and Wednesday. At this point in time, about 10 to 20% chance is what I'm expecting for the Metroplex. The farther north and west you live, the higher your rain chances for showers and thunderstorms, not necessarily a big severe weather threat. And then that front will actually lift northward by Thursday. High pressure from the southeastern states heads in this direction, and that just means sunshine and heat. That is when you'll notice temperatures starting to climb, not just mid-90s, but even some upper 90s as we head toward the end of the work week. Areas west of the I-35 corridor, that's where I think we could see some 100-degree marks for both Saturday and Sunday. But for us here around the Metroplex, Dallas and Fort Worth, pretty mild 70s, mid and upper 70s to start your morning. We'll see some clouds early on, but as the day goes on, partly to mostly sunny skies, looking pretty good, keeping your forecast dry with those high temperatures back into the mid 90s. And of course, once you factor in the humidity, it's going to feel a little warmer than that. Tuesday starts out pretty similar, but notice what models are doing. That front stays to our north. The bulk of the rain is going to be into parts of Oklahoma and even along the Red River and then back towards Wichita Falls. Not a whole lot going on for the first part of Tuesday. We'll have to continue to watch this as it develops going into Tuesday afternoon and Tuesday night, but I do think the better rain chances will be north and west for Tuesday, and that'll also hold on for your Wednesday as well. All right, here's a look at your planner through the overnight and heading into tomorrow. That south wind will be sustained up to 25 miles an hour. Hold on to your hats. 94 in the afternoon hour. That will be the high temperature for the day. And here are the next 7 days for you with your AccuWeather 41 forecast. More clouds and those smaller rain chances will lower our high temperatures just a couple of degrees. But once we have that high pressure move in starting Thursday, the sunshine takes over and so will the heat. We are expecting highs in the mid and upper 90s starting Friday through next weekend.
Thanks, Allie. A FEMA mobile disaster recovery center will be in the city of Carrollton this week. Workers will be talking with residents about property damage and loss from recent flooding. The mobile center will be set up in the first floor lobby of the city hall. It will be open Tuesday and Wednesday from 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. In Coppell, FEMA workers will be set up at fire station number 3 on Parkway Boulevard. They'll be open Friday from 10 a.m. to 10 p.m., Saturday from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. In Dallas, workers will be at the Walnut Hill Recreation Center. They'll be open Thursday from 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. Then again on Friday from 2 p.m. to 7 p.m. A father and a son survived being bitten by an alligator while taking a swim at a lake in southeast Texas. The attack happening at Lake Charlotte in Wallaceville. That's just east of Houston. Witnesses say 13-year-old Caleb Hurley was swimming near the bank in waist-deep water. The alligator reportedly came up and bit his arm, pulled him under. Hurley's father got in the water to save the boy. The gator let go of the boy, but immediately bit down on the father's leg.
To me, the only thing it felt like just like I told everybody else, like a sledgehammer or a bunch of needles. Like somebody laid my leg over and hit it with a 20-pound sledgehammer. That was the intense pain that hit.
The father and the son were both flown to the hospital for treatment. Wildlife officials say because of recent heavy storms and flooding, alligators have been displaced and many pop up in places where you normally would not find them. A young actress from North Texas getting big in Hollywood and starring now in a new show on Fox. You're going to meet her straight ahead. young actress from North Texas is building a name for herself in movies and in television. This fall, McKaley Miller is appearing on one of the top news shows here on the Fox Network. Dan Godwin takes a look in tonight's Fox Forward.
It's getting a little tougher to catch up with McKaley Miller these days because her thriving career is keeping her out west more and more. Thanks for coming in.
Of course. Thanks for having me.
You turned 19 years old last month. And then back in September, you moved permanently to Los Angeles because what? It was getting more challenging to go from Flower Mound, where you grew up, out to L.A. for work. Was that what was happening?
That was becoming sort of challenging, but it's also just being there is such a different experience. You go in the room for auditions instead of putting yourself on tape and then going back out for, you know, filming or callbacks. It was just, I don't know, that's where the business is. And so I was like, all right, it's 18, it's time to go for it and give myself a full like shot at being there and getting that whole experience.
Your parents and your brother still in Flower Mound,
yes.
So of course you'll be out here.
Of course.
Be out here plenty.
Yeah.
Okay, one of the major new offerings on the Fox Network this fall is a program called Scream Queens from much of the same creative team as Glee. McKaley has a recurring role on this program.
Yes.
Tell us, what's the idea behind the show?
Well, Ryan Murphy created American Horror Story and Glee.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like, I guess you could say if you mash those two together minus the singing.
Something really bad happened. She's dead.
So it's a dark comedy. It's so great. I think it's going to be something that no one has ever seen before on TV. And it centers around a college sorority and all of these killings start happening. So it's sort of like a mystery too, because you're like, well, who's the killer? What's happening? But it's great.
And then in August, there's the DVD release of the latest movie you appeared in.
Yes.
Where Hope Grows. Play the teenage daughter of a guy who's struggling with life.
You drunk again, Mr. Campbell?
Where do you think you're going?
Out with Colt?
No, you were 16 years old.
I'm 17, Dad.
What happened to us spending my birthday together?
I don't know.
Where Hope Grows is, I guess you could describe it as a family film, but there are some dark subjects, so I don't know if you would watch it with your little kids.
Do you have any idea what it's like picking up the man who calls himself your father at the police station? Hi.
There are just so many different stories and so many different messages that anyone that goes to watch this can take something away from it, and I think it's a really important film.
There are those who would think that success in the entertainment business is inevitably going to change someone. You just can't remain the same. What's your feeling about
it? I don't think so. I don't know. I think that success does change some people, I'm sure, but I don't think it would change me because I mean... Honestly, I'm not in it for the fame or to get to walk red carpets or anything like that. I'm in it for the love of acting and for the love of doing what I do. And so I don't really think any amount of success is going to change who I am. I have such an amazing family that keeps me grounded, and I'm just going to be the same old McKaley for the rest of my life.
All right, McKaley Miller, congratulations. Keep up the great work.
Thank you.
Again, Scream Queens this fall on the Fox Network, Where Hope Grows, coming out on DVD in August.
Yeah, right. Awesome, thank you.
Jurassic World and Inside Out were the most popular films this holiday weekend.
We got eyes on target.
Light it up!
Jurassic World brought in $30.9 million in its fourth week of release. Inside Out finished with $30.1 million. Terminator, the fifth entry in the sci-fi series, opened in third place. Magic Mike XXL and Ted 2 rounding out the top five. A Russian rocket succeeds after a private American company fails getting desperately needed supplies to the International Space Station. Details next on Fox 4 News at 9. Mission accomplished overnight in space. A cargo ship launched by a Russian rocket last week successfully docked at the International Space Station early this morning. The unmanned capsule delivered crucial supplies after recent resupply missions ended in failure. Just a week ago today, an unmanned rocket broke apart shortly after liftoff. It was launched by a private American company, SpaceX. The rocket and the supply capsule it carried disintegrated over the Atlantic Ocean just 2 minutes into that mission. Team USA got off to a hot start in the World Cup final match against Japan. We're going to hear more from the world champs next on Sports Sunday. An 18-year-old woman drowned at a popular beach in Granbury Saturday night. That's one of tonight's top stories. Officials say it happened at City Beach just off the boardwalk. Investigators have not determined if the woman jumped off the boardwalk or was simply swimming. A disturbing number of young people have drowned in Texas since January. The Department of Family and Child Protective Services puts the number now at 41. Gang detectives are investigating the shooting of a 12-year-old boy in Dallas. Police say it happened shortly before 2 in the 3500 block of Munger Avenue. Officers found the boy. He had multiple gunshot wounds and was taken to the hospital, but he's expected to live. Officers stopped a suspect's vehicle as it was leaving. Police say they questioned known gang members about that shooting.
Plenty of heat and humidity for the upcoming week. Small rain chances Tuesday and Wednesday. And by next weekend, we will be getting oh so close to that triple digit mark. Mid and upper 90s around Dallas and Fort Worth, but lots of sunshine will be in our forecast.
Tomorrow morning, a good day. Four-time Grammy-nominated R&B singer Tyrese Gibson Plus audition prep classes with the Dallas Mavericks dancers. And they're going to be making cupcakes with Society Bakery. That's getting your good day started here from 4:30 to 9 only on Fox 4. Stay right there. Sports Sunday's up next.
The following Fox 4 Sports presentation is brought to you by Clay Cooley Automotive.